Good morning, Rock Harbor Church. We're so grateful to be here this morning. If you would stand as we lift our voices in worship.
I want to put your hands together this morning. Let's have some fun in church today, right? I saw that, Nick. You can do it. Go for it.
God is a firm foundation, the rock on which we stand.
Our God, the firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Once strong, now shaken, we trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus.
We trust the name of Jesus.
We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
God is victorious in every aspect of our lives. He's conquered death. He's conquered everything. Let's lift this high. He is unmatched.
Matched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, as nations renew will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Oh, we trust the name of Jesus.
To be here in your presence, we ask that you fill this room with your spirit as we think back on all the things you've done throughout all of history, how you've been with your people when they got. gather in places like this. You fill us with your spirit, you fill us with your wisdom and your knowledge. So go before us, and that these words would be a reflection on who you are when we lift your name high.
Right here, right now. Oh yes, you know the ending. for the beginning, and I know that you have worked all things out.
Just good morning. As we come together and worship today, we're not done with worship yet, but I just wanted to share some scripture with you and just bring our focus to why we're here today. Peter shared with us in 1 Peter chapter 5. He says in verse 6, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you." For him, he was looking back. Today, we're going to take communion together. For him, it was a Seder meal. On the table would have been a lamb bone. And that bone would be there to remind them of God's strong hand. When he would look at that hand, they were remembering what God had done for them. They were remembering God's strong hand that helped them get out of slavery, helped them get out of oppression, led them out of the promised land. God's hand that struck the rock through Moses and water flowed. God's hand that parted the seas. God's hand that was there for him. But for Peter, God's hand was a little bit more maybe fleshy than the bone that we see on a Seder plate. For Peter, he knew what it was like to be struggling. He knew what it was like to be having times where he was sinking in the waves. And as he was seeking out, Jesus reached out his hand, picked him up, pulled him out of the waves, and didn't bring condemnation, but brought him forgiveness and hope and restoration. It continues and says, "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him." I was sharing with the boys, when I think of a roaring lion, my first reaction is what? To run from the roaring lion. But when we have the strength of God that we declare here this morning, we can stand here and we can resist the roaring lion of the devil and declare that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers through the entire world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. God, we just come, and as we come to this last song, we say these words. We declare these words. We sing these words. Do it again. God, we are declaring that what you have done, you will continue to do. And God, we believe that you are here with us this morning and that we are not alone, that we stand here together, not just with those that are online and those that are watching in other places, but we're standing beside our brothers and sisters in Christ all across this world, who today are declaring that we know the Messiah and his name is Jesus. Church, let's continue to worship this morning.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you would never fail me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence, you never failed me yet. night won't last. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. His promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Up, church. We're still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your
Jesus, we stand here and we lift high your name, knowing that even in the midst of desert, in the midst of fear and in the midst of chaos, that you were faithful to your people, Israel, that you made a promise, and by two unchangeable things, that God cannot lie, and that he fulfills his promises that was made. And we've seen throughout history and throughout the world that you have been with your people, and things don't always look or turn out the way that we want or we expect, but your faithfulness reigns supreme through all of that. So put that in our hearts and minds this morning as each person in this place comes in with a different story, comes in with a different circumstance in life. The greatest truth of it all is that you are faithful in the midst of all of those, and that each circumstance that we don't understand is something that you use to pull us closer to you, to pull us closer to you in faith and trust and in knowledge, to reassure us that you are for us and not against us. So we ask that we lay all of these things, all of these worries and all of these anxieties, all of these concerns about the present down on this altar this morning as we meet together. And we learn to put our trust and our hope and our faith in you, who's never failed us yet. We love you and we pray this all in your name. Amen. You can be seated.
All right, well, again, good morning and welcome to Rock Harbor Church. It is such a joy to have you with us this morning. Those of you that are here in our presence right now, those that are watching online, good morning and welcome to church with us. And so I'm excited for the brown box because Rustin has the brown box, and I cannot wait to see what he has put in the brown box. So Rustin's here for Rustin. Come on up, Rustin. Come on up, bud. Come on up. All right, and the box is helpful. There it is. There it is. That's what we got Big Brothers for. All right, Rustin. Man, is it heavy? I'll help you out. There we go. We got it. All right, Rustin, you got to come with it. All right, maybe if his brother comes with him. John, maybe if you come with him, he'll feel more comfortable. John, you want to come up here and see if Rustin will come with you? All right. I love it. Come on, brothers. Come on. All right, guys. Let's see what we've got. We've got Rustin, his big brother John with him, and we've got some awesome toys in here. And so we've got, is that a Triceratops? I don't know. That's got a lot of different horns going on there. A snake. We got a snake. What else is in there, Rustin? All right. We got a transformer. I think we've had this in our house at some point. Not this one, but one just like it. And we've got some bouncy balls. Do they bounce? John, do those bounce well? What do you think? All right. Here, this ground's a little harder. There we go. All right. And we've got an award. And we got a Hot Wheel. So we got all kinds of stuff to work with here this morning. So whose award was this, guys? Rustin, was this yours? This is your brother John's? All right. Yes? All right. So we've got a lot of stuff that we can look at here. And let's see. I'm going to look at this snake. This snake's interesting. And do you guys ever have snakes around your property? Yeah, you guys get snakes around your property? I think we all get snakes around our property. And John, was that your award, the award that was there? Yes? Okay. Rustin, what were you thinking when you put all this stuff in the brown box? Yep, you just put stuff in the brown box. All right, then. Let's see, what does this teach you guys about Jesus this morning? Well, I know for one, if I see a snake, do you guys like snakes? John, you like snakes? Rustin, you like snakes? You like snakes? See, you like snakes. If I see a snake, I'm gonna run away from a snake. I think snakes are kind of scary. And even if I saw this snake, I might think that it's kind of scary. And sometimes, Rustin, you know what I think is so interesting about this whole thing? I could find all these different things in the box, but I'm going to look at your brother who's sitting right next to you. And we think about being anxious. And Rustin, you didn't want to come up here by yourself, did you? No. But when you had your brother with you, you felt less anxious. And so you know what? I might do something different. Instead of picking something that's in the brown box, I love the fact that you wanted to come up here with your brother. And that you were anxious, Rustin, and that you were a little afraid. But when your brother came and he sat with you, that things felt better. And that's true for us as adults. Sometimes life gets a little scary, and we have all these different choices and all these different things that we can play with and do. And when we have a person who loves us and cares for us, that we can feel less anxious. Does that make any sense, guys? All right, we're going to go with that one today. I like it. Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for Rustin, Lord. Thank you that he enjoys so many different things. I know that Rustin likes to play, and he likes to play a lot. He likes to play in front of his house. He likes to play in the pool. He likes to play in the ocean with his mom, dad, and his big brother. So God, just thank you for Rustin and all the different toys that he likes to play with, and that when he gets nervous or he gets afraid, he knows that his big brother's there for him, his parents are there for him, and God, we are so thankful that that's how we can handle our anxieties sometimes. And so God, we thank you for that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Rustin, I'm glad your brother's here. He can help you grab all these toys. Here you go, guys. All right. Thank you, Rustin, for not putting a live snake in the brown box. I'll hand that to you. Thank you, guys. All right. The brown box is going to Zoe. Zoe gets the brown box today. So Zoe, if you want to come up here and grab the brown box. If you haven't noticed that this time we invite our kids to go to our children's ministry. So if you have a child up to fifth grade, you would like them to be with our children's program where they'll get teaching and games according kind of to their age group. They're welcome to head out with our children's ministry now and they'll split into their groups. All right. So Zoe, this is for you. I know you're a little older, you know, so you just wanted to make sure. We go up to fifth grade, so we wanted to give it to you while we still could. Hey, guys, if you could stand up and greet those around you, that would be awesome. Thank you.
All right, Rock Harbor family. I'm so glad that we are able to socialize. Praise the Lord. When I grew up, we called it the right hand of Christian fellowship. Yeah, that tells you where I'm from. But I'm glad we get to do this again. I'm so thankful. So welcome this morning, guys. I hope everybody's doing great. Just wanted two really quick announcements. The first one, let's go with the app. We have a brand new app that we are rolling out. We're getting into the 2022 world, which is way ahead of me. But it's very exciting. So if you can go on Apple, you can look in your bulletin, I believe. There's a QR code you can just scan with your phone. But if you grab that app for the church, for Rock Harbor Church, there's a lot more great stuff coming there. Great place to connect with groups, connect with each other, find out the events that are going on. And also, we have a little incentive. We have three of these Four Ocean recycled glass bracelets that, if you're like me, I see them every time I check out somewhere at a store, and I'm like, those are super cute, but I'm not spending the money on it. Well, you could actually win one for free. So we've got three of these we're going to give away in a couple weeks. Once people start downloading the app, we're going to choose three people. Lucky winners will get an exotic Tropical Island of Bali handmade glass bead bracelet. So I'd love to have you guys, look, Sage is so excited. I'd love to have you guys be able to win that. But most importantly, we want you guys to connect with the church and just everything that's going on here. And speaking of connecting with the church, I believe if this is your home church, I want you guys to know, we always talk about this, we don't give to Rock Harbor, we give through Rock Harbor. And our church is so honored to be a part of so many incredible opportunities to serve and give in this neighborhood, in this community, also just within our own fellowship of each other, to support things, to have classes, to have programs, to have gatherings and fellowships, but we can't do that without everybody in the body pitching in together to be a part of that. So you can give in the back of the box. You can give online. Can you give on the app yet? Woohoo, you can give on the app. So we'd love to have you guys join us and be a part of the awesome work God is doing in this church. And then one last thing, on Saturday, any women, and I use that term women, I'm talking young ladies 10 and up, if you believe that they are prepared and mature enough to handle it, would love to have you guys come and join us Saturday for our quarterly women's brunch. Please bring a dish to share if you are able to. It is a beautiful time of fellowship, a great time of just getting to know some other incredible women. Bring your friends. It's not just for Rock Harbor women. Bring anyone you want. And we're going to hear some stories of gratitude from three very wonderful women in our own community sharing how they have seen the power of gratitude in the times in their lives that the Lord has been who he said he would always been and brought them through that. So it is, again, here Saturday, 9:30 in the Fellowship Hall. So we hope to see you there.
We are going into our second week on a series called Emotions, and today, if you haven't figured out, we are talking about the emotion of anxiety. And an interesting little fact about this morning was I almost didn't make it to church this morning because I deal with some anxiety issues, and it is stomach-related. And so a couple hours ago, I wasn't sure if I was going to be here to give this message on anxiety, and I am here, and I'm so glad to be with each and every one of you. And one thing I just want to say from the very beginning as we talk about these things called emotions is I know Jesus, I love Jesus, I'm a follower of Jesus, and I deal with anxiety and other emotions, and today I'm speaking about anxiety from the perspective of the Bible and how we can see how Jesus dealt with anxiety and how we can learn from how he dealt with it. But I also fully recognize that anxiety has other connections with us. I know my diet can impact my anxiety, and yes, I take medicine on a daily basis for my anxiety. So I just want to kind of share that to let people know that I'm not coming from this perspective of if we simply just listen to this message that all your anxiety should go away, but that all these different emotions that we deal with come from a lot of different complexities. And I think that is, as we see in Scripture, is that God works in all these different ways for our good. Some of you can look back at what has been this past few years now, it seems like. I guess it's only the past couple of years. And the anxiety that we have felt kind of throughout our world has definitely been on the increase. In 2020, we saw anxiety increase in a very powerful way. And just when we thought things were getting better and we were getting into 2021, we get into the summer and things really felt like they got more difficult than ever. And there wasn't as many people rallying around those that were struggling financially or the businesses that were hurting. And anxiety has continued. In fact, as we look at some of the statistics that have come out, according to the National Center for Health, in July of 2019, about 8% of adults showed signs of an anxiety disorder. As we got into July of 2020, 36% of adults showed signs of an anxiety disorder. So we can see that it definitely has had an impact on our lives these past couple of years as far as how we deal with anxiety and how many of us are dealing with anxiety. It was September of 2021 that I found that 27% of adults, so just last month, showed signs of an anxiety disorder. One interesting thing in the statistics is the younger ages actually show the highest levels. The 18 to 29-year-olds, actually 42%, had shown signs of high anxiety. It was in the 30s, as you get to the from age 30 to age 50, it was around 30%. And once you got to like over 70, it finally got back down to like 10%. And I think you could have some fun ways of understanding why that is. Maybe those that were being impacted the most actually were having the least anxiety and what we could learn from that. in this message series, as we look at the anxieties and the emotions, I mean, that Jesus had, today we're going to focus on this way of anxiety. And we can see that Christ felt anxiety, that Jesus Christ was anxious. And I think that thought alone can give us a lot of comfort. So as we talk about anxiety in this context of church, this context of our Christian faith, we can easily ask this question: if I feel anxious, did I fail? Am I failing as a Christian if I feel anxious? Am I letting God down? Am I not living according to my faith? Am I not spiritual enough, a good enough Christian, that I'm feeling anxious? And the really similar context is, you know, is it a sin to be anxious? And it's no more sin to be anxious than it's a sin to be angry. But the reality is, many times, our anxiety, just like our anger, will lead us to making decisions that aren't healthy and aren't good and aren't pure when we don't deal with either in a healthy way. Ephesians 4, verse 26 says, "In your anger, do not sin." And I think we can apply that to anxiety as well. In our anxiety, in our emotions, do not sin. The emotion itself is nothing that should carry guilt with us. It's nothing that should make us feel like we've done something wrong, but it's simply something that we deal with. And we're going to see that through Scripture, we can learn some ways on how to deal with our anxiety. And it may surprise you, and I hope that it comforts you to know that Jesus battled his emotions and anxiety as well. When you look at the Son of God, Jesus, and you look at how he dealt and endured with anxiety, he actually dealt with some extraordinary anxiety. And the time that we're going to look at today is going to be the time that he was leading up to the cross. As he looked ahead to the suffering that he was about to endure, the price that he would pay, as Jesus knew that he was about to give his life as a ransom for the sin of all mankind. In fact, today I want to look specifically at how he responded to this anxiety. And there's a few different things that we're going to look at. And what we're going to see is that whenever anxiety ramped up, Jesus talked back. He talked back and would actively engage in his anxiety. And so I want to do this with him today. I want to kind of wrestle with this idea and see how Jesus overcame anxiety. We're going to show you three different places out of Mark chapter 14. If you have your Bibles or you've got your Bible app, if you want to pull that up. And also, we're going to fill in the blanks here in just a moment, so you can do that as well. I believe on the app, if you go to the This Week tab, you can actually fill in the blank of the notes on the app today for the first time. And I believe that's happening. So the first question that we're going to kind of focus on here, our question for today: how do you find relief from your anxiety? The number one thing was actually a great example of what we saw from Rustin and John this morning, and that is you talk to your friends. You talk to your friends. Whenever you're feeling overwhelmed, you're feeling anxious, you're feeling the heaviness or weight of life, it's really wise to talk to your friends. And I'm going to put a little caveat in that and say it's really wise to talk to people who you know are going to give you wise, godly, spiritual, Christ-centered responses. You could talk to your friends in times of anxiety, and it could actually be the most unhelpful thing that you do. And so we're going to see this context today of who Jesus talked to. He didn't just talk to random people in the crowd. He talked to very specific people, even inside the 12, when he was dealing with anxiety. So here we are in Mark 14 to give you some of the context. This is after the Last Supper. So today we kind of have our mini version of the Seder meal here that we will take at the end of the service that we call communion. After this Last Supper, essentially he was with his small group, his disciples, his inner 12 as they are in the upper room. Verse 26 of Mark 14 reminds us that they would have sung a hymn, which was the tradition even today for the Seder meal, is to end by singing a hymn and to leave in song. They sung this hymn, and Jesus' close friend Judas had left and was no longer with them. Jesus had left the upper city of Jerusalem where they were having this meal. He would have departed on the northwest side and walked around the wall and then moved towards the south, where he would have gone towards the Mount of Olives, which is a very large region between Jerusalem and Bethany. He would have crossed over the brook that I talked about a few weeks ago that would have had the blood of the lambs flowing from the temple down through gravity into the Kidron Valley. He would have walked over that brook that normally would be very small, but at that moment would have been gushing with the blood of 125,000 lambs that had just been crucified, or not crucified, slaughtered a few hours before. He goes to this Mount of Olives, and at that point, he gets his three buddies, and they go to the Garden of Gethsemane. That word Gethsemane, if you really even understand the place that he chose to be, he had his small group, he had his disciples, his inner 12, and now he goes and he gets his three closest buddies and goes to the garden whose name means the place to be crushed. That's where Jesus chose to be, in this place. Now, the reason why it was called the place to be crushed is because within the Mount of Olives, the Garden of Gethsemane is where they had the presses. Because you can buy olives for relatively cheap. But to get a pure, fine olive oil is very expensive. You see, the olive is cheap, but what makes it so valuable is after it experiences the crushing. When the two wheels are pressed and the grapes or the olives are pushed in between, and the oil that comes out is what was great value. And we're going to see that in Jesus' most anxious time, he chooses to go to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he is going to begin to be crushed for the sins of all mankind. Now, why a garden? Why would Jesus choose to be in this garden place? He left Jerusalem, the holy city, to be in this garden place. And I think there's a few reasons why. One, this all started in a garden called the Garden of Eden. It will all end, according to Revelation 22, in the garden city of the new Jerusalem that Christ will lead and rebuild in all of its glory in eternity. In the middle, we have another very important garden. As we come between these two beginning and ends, we see that Jesus stands here in the middle. The first garden, the first Adam, was overcome by sin. Here we'll see this second Adam will overcome sin as he leads his way to the cross. In the Garden of Eden, the first Adam ran from God because of sin. Here in this garden in the middle, the final Adam, according to 1 Corinthians 15, presents himself to the Father's will to pay the price for sin. What a beautiful moment to stand here in Jesus' most anxious moment. Verse 32, if you want to follow along with me. They went to the olive grove called Gethsemane. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray." He took Peter, James, and John with him, and he became deeply troubled and distressed. Jesus, the Son of God, was perfect, had never sinned, was deeply distressed in this moment. In the Message version, it says this for verse 33, he plunged into a sinkhole of dreadful agony. I don't know, for me, I relate well to that verse. There's been times in my life that I was so anxious, I felt like I was in a sinkhole of dreadful agony. I wonder if any of you have been to a place like that. I wonder if any of you are feeling like you're in a place like that. Like your heart is beating so hard, it's going to come out of your chest. You can't catch your breath, and you just feel like you're sitting in darkness, and there's panic all around you. You can just feel it on your skin sometimes when you're feeling that anxious. He sat and sank in this dark hole of dreadful agony, he who knew no sin. Well, why did he do this? Why would he allow himself to even go through this? Well, Jesus was God, but he was also God in the flesh. And he knew the horror that was about to come to his flesh. Even though he was completely innocent, he was going to be arrested, beaten, tortured, and die a death by crucifixion. The most painful and completely humiliating possible way to die. Even worse, he knew he didn't deserve to be there. He was about to become sin as the sacrifice for our sins. Can you imagine just this point alone? He had never sinned, so he had never been separated from God. He had never been separated from complete, perfect communion with his Father in heaven. He was going to go to a place that all of mankind's sin was going to be poured on him. And I share that because we are so fixated on the physical brutality of the cross at times that we forget about probably the most anxious moment of Jesus' life was knowing that he was going to be separated and the sin that he had never experienced and never deserved was going to be placed on him. And maybe we should just name what that is. It was going to be hatred. It was going to be abuse, murder, racism, rape was going to be placed on him. That sin. And sometimes we forget that. All the times that we have turned our back on God, knowingly or unknowingly, through word or deed, all of that time was going to be brought and put on Christ to be crucified on the cross. Holiness was about to become filthiness. 2 Corinthians 5, one of my favorite chapters, says in verse 21, "For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering of our sin, so that we could be made right through God, with God through Christ. The one who never sinned became sin. And because of it, his Father, who loved and always walked with him in communion, had to turn away because of the holiness of God. He could not look upon his Son while he sat on the cross." We fast forward just a little bit. Jesus cries out on the cross, my God, Daddy, where are you? Where have you gone? Why have you turned away? Why have you forsaken me?" That's the anxious moment that I believe Christ was looking to most, in the middle of that sinkhole. That emotional agony. Watch the honesty that Jesus is about to have with his friends. Before we read this next verse, have you ever noticed that no one can lie as well as a Christian at times? We do the best of, well, we're just, you know, trying to show a good image. We just want to look our best for church. We just want everybody to not have to worry about our problems. But the reality is, I want you just to hear it in this context that as Christians, I think we sometimes are the best liars in our community. As Jesus is here in this moment, here's what he says. He says, "Guys, my friends, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. In other words, I ache so much that my internal insides, I don't know if I can survive." Have you ever felt that anxiousness? That you feel so anxious in a moment that you don't know if you can physically survive. I know moments in my life where I've had to just focus on my breathing because I was so anxious. My body was so overcome with anxiety that I just had to focus on the fact that, Kevin, just keep on breathing. Let's just breathe through this moment. Breathe in, breathe out. Just get through this. And get through this moment. I think what's so hard, as I've been studying this for a few weeks, is that for the younger people that are in this room, for you teenagers that are hearing this message, the reality is the studies show that for you that are young, those moments of high anxiety, you actually don't even have the reference point of, I'm going to get through this at time. And that's why we see these issues of anxiety and depression be so difficult. It's because those of us that are older, we've been through some times of anxiety, and we've gotten through them. But when you're young and you experience something, it's like, I don't know if this is ever going to end. This is how my life's always going to be. And our human mind is wired that way. And that's why we have to give so much care to our teens that are in school and dealing with true anxious desires in their lives. One of the biggest reasons that we feel so anxious may be because we're lacking Christian community. And Jesus says to his friends, the three, would you please just stay here and keep watch? I need you more than I can describe. That's what Jesus says to his friends. You know what's so interesting is? I've been reading this text wrong my whole life. You know what he doesn't say here? Pray for me. I've always thought the whole time that he always said, would you just stay awake and pray with me? But as you read Mark's account says, would you please just stay here and keep watch? I need you more than I can describe. He needed his friends to just be with you. Have you ever had that moment? You know, one of the things as a chaplain I would always try and tell people is sometimes the least we say in the most anxious moments is the best. That literally there was one time I sat next to a lady, her daughter was going through a code blue, her daughter had stopped breathing. And I get there and she knew absolutely no English and I know extremely little Spanish. And I sat there and I had, this book is one of the books I had with me. And so I had this book with me in the hospital. And all I could do in this moment was point to the cross of this book I have in my hand. I pointed to the cross and she says, yes. And I say, pray. And she says, yes. And I pray with this mother while her infant child is getting CPR done to her, which is not a beautiful thing to see like you see in the movies. And we're sitting there next to them and that is happening. And I pray in English and I get ready to say amen. And she starts praying in Spanish. And I don't know what she said, but we were together in that moment. We couldn't communicate. We couldn't lift each other up. And then after she got done praying, we said amen together and we just sat there. And we were together side by side. And that's what we need sometimes in these anxious moments, is to know that someone cares for me. To know that someone is praying with me. To know that someone is there and they're coming alongside me. There's so many people that we're feeling unsettled in these days. We're scared to death, and that makes us so vulnerable to whatever the latest rumor on the news is coming out, because we may be lacking that godly, encouraging, uplifting, spiritual building community from the body of Christ. In fact, I'm guessing it's going to take years of study to look back on this season and to see the impacts on what quarantine and isolation have done to so many people in so many different communities. Again, I'm so thankful that we get to be in a place where I drive up and down A1A and I see people outside exercising and getting a chance to enjoy the life that God has given us. Because God said it's not good for one to live in isolation all the way back from that very first garden. In fact, who is Jesus? Jesus is the incarnation, God in flesh, Emmanuel, God what? God with us. The power of being with is the reason why Jesus came. God didn't just like shout down from heaven like he had done maybe a little bit in the past. He didn't just burn a bush. He didn't just strike down and give us tablets from a mountainside. He chose to come be with us because that's how important God values relationship. It's the power of with, the power that was in the body of Christ. The difference between praying for someone and praying with someone, I love to pray for you. I love the fact that you know that your connection cards, if you turn those in, that our church will be praying for you, and that is powerful. But I am praying that our church comes a day that we don't just pray for people, but that we more pray with people. If you don't know, one of the visions for this church is that at the end of our service, when we come time for worship, it's not the, that means we can be eating in 15 minutes song, but it's the song that means now's the time that we can pray with each other. And that you have the opportunity to come forward and pray and know that people aren't just going to say, hey, fill out a connection card and we'll pray for you later. But there's something powerful about having a person come up alongside you and with permission lay a hand on your shoulder and pray with you, and to feel that when two or more are gathered, the Holy Spirit is at work. Please continue to fill in the connection cards. Please continue to ask us to pray for you. But we also want to be a church that prays with you. Jesus, the sinless Son of God, says to his friends who are full of doubt and sin, and at that time, ignorance of even who he truly was. He said, I need you. He talks to them. He says, this is crushing me. I don't know if I can make it through this. Would you guys just sit here and stay close to me while I go and pray? My soul is overwhelmed. It feels like I can't make it. Please, please, just stay close to me. Step number one, talk to your friends. And if you don't have friends that are pointing you to Jesus, get involved with one of our groups that we have for the church. We've got a lot of different options available right now. And let us get you connected in a group. The information's in your bulletin. Just write on the connection card, you want to be in a small group, and we'll reach out to you and find that group. Number two is this, if you're taking notes, talk to your father. Talk to your father. Let me explain it to you this way. I don't know if this creates anxiety in you, but do you ever have a car that when you're driving, like these little warning lights show up in front of you? We've got a few of those. In fact, both of our cars right now have lights that we choose to live with. The one car has four lights in the middle. And what's so funny is there's a guy here, I'm not sure where Glenn's at the moment, but Glenn actually knows how to fix it. And he's told me how to fix it. He's told me, just bring your car to church and give me your keys and I can take it to my shop and we can fix it. But I choose to live with this. And it's just basically telling me I have no air in any of my tires, which I'm pretty sure isn't true. So we just continue to live with that. Oh, and our brakes are on, and our emergency brakes on, and our something else isn't even working. ABS doesn't work according to the lights. But it's just the lights, we think. And so we choose to live with it. And so many of us do that with our own lives, and it's crazy. We choose to live with these things that are telling us that there's something wrong and not addressing it. Can I tell you what anxiety is? Many times it's a little red light that goes off in your life that tells you there's something not wrong, right? There's something unhealthy. When I was a baseball player, a lot of the pitchers, they would use Bengay, they would take Advil before they pitched. My pitching coach growing up said, never take any medicine until about an hour after the game and listen to exactly what your body's telling you. When your arm starts to hurt and you can't throw the ball, you should probably stop throwing the ball. And I think we should do the same thing. Instead of choosing to numb our pain, instead of choosing to take something to make us feel better, with the caveat that I've said, I take medicine, I'm talking about taking other things that try to make us feel better. And we try and numb ourselves instead of paying attention to the pain that's in our body and then talking to our father, talking to our friends, and addressing the issues that we have. Philippians 4, verse 6 says this, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, with prayer and petition, you take your request to who? You take your request to God. Let me tell you this, he is big enough to hear any anxiety that you're dealing with. And I want you to hear this. I think I got this for the screen. If it's big enough to worry about, it's big enough to pray about. If there is anything in your life that is causing you worry, pray about it. If there's anything in your life that's causing you anxiety, pray about it. If it's big enough to worry about, it's big enough to pray about. Let's not keep these things inside, but let's take these things. If you're worried about your marriage, I hope you're praying about it. If you're worried about your health, I hope you're praying about it. If you're worried about the decisions of what to do with kids in school, the economy, all these different things that we just burden on ourselves, pray about it. Take it to God in prayer. Don't keep this on your own, because listen to this. If it's on your mind, it's on God's heart. He cares about these things, but he doesn't want you to do it alone. Jesus talked to his friends. He talked to his father. Going a little further, Jesus fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup. Take this cup. Why do we use that language? Take this cup away from me. Why is he, what cup is he talking about? He's talking about the cup that was on the Seder meal that we will take today in remembrance of him, that represented the blood that would be shed, not just from the lambs and their temporary sacrifice, but the internal sacrifice of the Messiah for the forgiveness of all mankind. Can we look at this in a moment and see what Jesus was asking? He's saying, Father, is there any other way for me not to have to endure what I'm about to endure so that all these other people can receive forgiveness from me? That's what he was saying in this moment. Take this cup from me. Please, I don't want to suffer in this way. I don't think he was being selfish in this, because I don't think he had that ability to be selfish. But you know what he was being in this? He was being something that I'm not very good at doing in my prayers many times, and that is being honest. He was being honest. Do you see the honesty of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who said, I don't want to have to go through all this? I don't want to have to be nailed to a cross. Is there any other way for this to happen? And I think the reason why this becomes so difficult is because from the very beginning, when our kids are young, we teach them simple prayers. And we teach them simple prayers about our meals and going to bed. And we don't teach kids from the beginning just to be real and talk with God. In fact, can I be honest? Some of the prayers we tell kids, they're kind of messed up and just cause anxiety. Imagine praying this before you go to bed. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I mean, this is not a great prayer to teach our kids. I pray the Lord my soul to take. Who else is trying to take my soul now? Anybody taught that prayer when you were young? I mean, come on. It's like, let's just start off by just teaching our kids, by teaching ourselves. Let's pray with some honesty as we come to prayer. Jesus cries out from the depths of his soul. And that's exactly what God wants from you. He wants your honesty. Angie and I were at a camp one time when a teenager that was struggling with this idea of, should I give my life to this Jesus or not? And in conversations, I told him, and he was 18 years old, I was like, dude, just go out in the woods and use any kind of language you want. He's heard it before. And just go tell God exactly what you're feeling and what you're mad at. He had some stuff happen to his family and his life, and he was angry. So just go out there and just go and pray. And he goes out there, and God didn't respond. He goes back in, and at that point, we were having music, and he's just kind of listening. He's zoned out. I'm not going to sing to a Jesus I don't believe. And as he's sitting there, after having his first ever honest conversation with God, he begins to hear a voice that just says, kneel before me and worship me. And then all of a sudden, he feels hands come on his shoulders. It began to push him down. And God responded to his prayer and showed him that he was there, showed him that he was God, and showed him that he was real. And this big, tough guy in the middle of a, you know, teen camp just breaks down and gives his life to the Lord because he finally said an honest prayer in his life. 1 Peter chapter 5 that I read during the worship says, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Here's the problem with our Bible sometimes, is the NIV translation makes this a hard verse to understand. Because in the NIV translation, it puts this phrase in one clear defined sentence with a period and a capital letter. And it makes you feel like this is the command that's being given. Let me show you this in context that the ESV does a good job of bringing up. The ESV shows this. It's all one verse with maybe a comma in between. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Do you see the command that's here? The command that's here is not to cast all your anxieties, to cast all your cares. The command that's being given here is humble yourselves. Humble yourselves. Be honest with God. Recognize that God's strong hand is on the throne and you are not. When you humble yourself before God, the result is that you can cast all your cares upon him. But so many times we go through life and we just try to cast all our cares on, hey, God, I'm dealing with this issue. Just take it. I'm dealing with this issue. Just take this from me, God. This isn't going my way. Just take this from me, God. And he's saying, yeah, you're saying, do this for me, 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 me. And God's saying, but you're not being humble. That we humble ourselves before God. We try to keep the pride and cast the anxiety. We try to keep control and give him all our cares. But they are a package deal is the way that this verse is written. Let me ask you, what is in the middle of the word anxiety or anxious? What's in the middle of it? Stephen, let's not give him the answer quite yet. What's in the middle of the word anxious? All right, Stephen, let's show him. Anxious. The middle is I. What's the middle of pride? You're allowed to talk back. What's the middle of pride? And what's in the middle of sin? I. You see, so many times we're so focused on, God, just take my anxiety, take my cares, take my worries. Take these things away. Maybe you need to humble yourself before God and let God speak. Maybe, God, I don't know if I have what it takes to get through this week. God, you know, I was talking to God last week, and I was trying to talk to him and be honest. I said, God, I don't know how I was able to get our church through the first 2 years with all the different complications that we went through. Did you hear what I said? And God said, Kevin, you didn't. I said, God, I don't know how we got through these first 2 years. I don't know how we're going to get through the next 2 years. He goes, well, the first 2 years weren't because of you, so the next 2 years won't be either. And when we get to that place where we can humble ourselves, do you feel how the anxiety can just melt away from me? When no longer it's my shoulders and Angie's shoulders and the two of us having to do this church on our own, but we realize that this church doesn't happen because of the two of us. But this church happens because God is at work and he's doing all this. Do you see how my pride put the anxiety on my shoulders? And when God speaks to me in humility, it can just begin to step away and realize I'm not carrying this alone, but we're carrying this together. And we do this thing called church because we're together. This is the command that God gives us. The result of humbling yourself is you get yourself out of the center and you put Christ on the throne where he deserves. I promise you. God would rather you be honest and unleash on him than be a hypocrite as we come to him in prayers. He can handle anything you have to tell him. He's heard it before. There's something healing about telling God when you're afraid, about telling God when you're doubting, telling God when you don't understand, telling God when you're upset about the way things are. He can handle your honesty, but God can't help you in your silence. Just come to God and say, Father, things are falling apart. I'm finding it hard to trust you right now. I can't even catch my breath. Why couldn't you? Why didn't you? I know you could and you didn't. Where are you? God, what's going on? Why are you allowing this to happen? Maybe that's the honesty that God needs to begin to work in you. God, I'm trying to trust you, but I'm finding it really difficult right now. That kind of honesty, I'll tell you this, it works. It absolutely works. Jesus says, hey, if we can do it any other way, my soul's being crushed right now. I know what's happening. I'm telling you, if there's any other way, God, I'm begging you, if we can do it any other way. But God, I'm willing. God, I'm willing. I'm willing to follow whatever it is that you ask of me. The last thing, if you're taking notes, write this in. Talk to your feelings. You see, sometimes we need to talk back to our feelings. Anybody ever have feelings that you know are taking you in a really bad direction? I hear people all the time say, oh, just follow your heart. Follow your feelings. You realize that some of us followed our feelings today, by 2 o'clock you'd be in jail. I mean, there's probably some truth to that. Your sister might hate you. Your brother's never going to talk to you again. Your next door neighbor is going to build a wall between their house and yours. If you follow your feelings, things could happen that really aren't good. Sometimes you need to talk to your feelings. Because listen, you are not your feelings. Your feelings do not control you. Sometimes you need to tell your feelings that. Hey, you don't control me. I control me, and what controls me is not my feelings. I'm going to stand on the truth of who I am. My feelings are not going to be the boss of me. Jesus says, Abba, Father, everything's possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yet, not what I will, but God, what you will. That's what Jesus did. He said, I'm not really feeling like dying on a cross today. I'm not really feeling like being arrested and beaten for something that I didn't do. I'm not really feeling that today. But God, I'm going to tell my feelings that they don't control me. They don't control who I am. And I'm going to follow the plan that God has for me, even if it's going to be difficult, even if it's going to be hard. He didn't want to be rejected. He didn't want to be abused. But he stood up to his feelings. Whenever you start to feel like, well, maybe God doesn't love me, you say, no, no, no. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, for God so loved the world, and that includes me, that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Whenever you feel like nobody cares for you, you tell your feelings, no, no, no. The Bible tells you that my God loves me, that my God will never leave me, that my God will never forsake me. Whenever you begin to worry about your finances, and oh my gosh, there's only so much left, and we owe this and we owe that, you can tell yourself that my God is my abundant provider. He will meet all my needs according to his glories and riches. When you feel like you can't go on, you tell yourself, you tell your feelings, no, I can do all things through God who gives me strength. When you feel like you're a victim, you tell your feelings, no, I am an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the words and the testimony of Jesus Christ. What did Jesus do with his anxiety? He talked to his friends, he talked to his father, and he told the truth to his feelings. Some of you, you've got to start telling your feelings to get in line. You got to tell your feelings to get in line with my faith. Get in line with the truth of the Word of God. What did Jesus do? He told his feelings that I'm willing to do the will of the Father, and it worked. Do you know how we know that it worked? Jesus didn't just stumble into the garden. He didn't just come in overwhelmed and crushed with defeat. Yes, the soldiers came and arrested him. Yes, he would face unjust trials. Yes, he would go through unspeakable torture. Yes, he would go through excruciating pain on the cross. Yes, he would go through those things. But in the midst of those moments, in the midst of that time, he didn't completely fall apart. He didn't completely become who he wasn't the entire time. He stood strong in his faith. And he determined that I am going to follow the will of the Father. This is who I am. This is who I'm called to be. And he stood in front of Pilate. He stood in front of everybody. And he continued to be who God asked him to be. And that's the call that we have in our lives, is to follow Jesus Christ, even when it's hard, even when it's difficult, and know that he is with us. Church, would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord, I'm so thankful that we can stand on your truth. God, I'm so thankful to know that you are here today and we can declare who you are. God, I'm so thankful that today we can do more than that and we can actually taste who you are. We can remember who you are as we taste today. The bread that represents your body that was broken. The juice that represents your blood that was shed for us. God, thank you that you are with us. God, thank you that you have guided us. God, I know that there's many here today who are struggling with many of these issues. And I know that I'm not the only one. God, I'm so thankful that you declared in John 10 that no one would take your life from you. but that you would lay it down on your own accord. That, God, that you stood in the garden resolute, strong, determined, unshakable, because you had said in your scripture, I have authority to lay my life down, and I will have authority to take it up again, because this command you received from your Father. And in that moment, where everybody else thought that you had lost and you were broken, you stood there and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. As you said the words, into your hands I commit my spirit, you said, it is finished. You had done everything according to the will of the Father. Because of that, today, we can stand on the hope and truth that you have forgiven us our sins, that you have conquered death so that you could give us life and life to the full. Pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Church, let's stand and worship him.
Mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again to your family. Your love flows through my veins. I'm no longer. Child of God, I'm
child of God. I am a child of God.
Friends, we come to this sacred table not because we must, but because we may. We come to testify not that we are righteous, but that we are sincerely in love and following our Lord Jesus Christ, and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because we are weak. Not because we have any claim on the grace of God, but because in our sinfulness we stand in constant need of God's mercy and grace. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek God's presence and pray for his Spirit. Would you pray with me? Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, in word, and deed. By what we have done, by what we have left undone, perhaps we have not loved with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. But God, we are truly sorry and we humbly repent for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways in the glory of God forever. Amen. This is an open table. You don't have to be a member of this church, which we don't have yet, but we don't have to be a member of this church. We simply ask that you are a follower of Jesus Christ and you desire to follow Christ and live in his will. If so, you are welcome to this table. If there are some children that are still making decisions to follow Christ or not, in the middle of the table we'll have some grapes and they can come and they can get a grape to get a tasting of what is yet to come with the fullness and forgiveness in Jesus Christ. Listen to the words that were delivered by the Apostle Paul, who said, "For I received from the Lord what I also hand to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, he took the loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after the sup, saying, 'This cup,'" the cup that we spoke of in Mark, "'this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" If I can invite the LaJoys to join us. We're going to have a couple different options today. I know people are in different places of receiving communion in public right now. So, my children's ministry wants me to remind you, the preschoolers, you can still pick them up afterwards. And we do have cups that Billy has at the back. So if you would like to get a pre-done cup that is, you know, guaranteed to be completely available for you at the back, you can get one as well. But we would also like to serve you at the table. And so as we've tried to work through these crazy things, what to do best, Brian and I just went and washed our hands as deep as we would for surgery, and we are going to serve the bread to you instead of having everybody else put their hands in to pick the cup or cup the bread. If you choose to get a pre-done one, you may as well. All right, come, for all is now ready. Oh, if you could come through the back and come up the center aisle, then we'll return to our seats through the side. That way we can have some flow. That'd be great. All right, come, for all is now ready. first. It's been more clear, but let's, if you haven't already, this is the body of Christ broken for you. Let's take this together. And likewise, this is the blood of Christ shed for you. All right, church, don't forget those preschoolers. Don't leave them in there. Go into your week, be honest with God, share with God, love God, follow Jesus, and have a great week. Amen.